Welcome to another lecture of wireless communication course. In this lecture, we're going to present another approach to channel modeling. In the previous lecture, we talked about a physical model, and we said that the transmitter has some signals on the air, and the receive signal is modeled by electric field, this strength, and based on the environment, either it is free space or it has some reflector in between, we can express the receive signal based on as a function of distance, delay, frequency, and time. Now, in this model, we derive an input-output model. In this case, we consider that the channel acts like a system. So, we have input and output. The transmitter produces a signal as an input to the system, and the received signal, the receiver receives the signal and acts as an output of the system. So, unlike the previous model, there is a relationship between the output and input. So, the output is expressed as an input, and the system is considered as a time-varying linear system. So, since we have many paths, so the effects of this multipath is considered as the variation, the summations of some expressions. So each path has its own relation of an input and output, so that we can make summation on all of these paths. And the model also can be presented as a baseband model, and also we can sample that continuous model to get the equivalent discrete time model. And finally, we can add the additive noise to the received signal. So here we have an input-output model. Here the receive signal can be expressed by a summation of all of the signals comes from different paths. So if we have I path, then the receive signal is by using the principle of superposition, it can be expressed by the summation of each individual signal. That is, one of the equals to summation where I, one loss factor, that is a function of time and frequency, multiplied by the signal itself, which is the delay version of the transmitted signal. And also the delay is a function of time and frequency. So here we have note that the loss factor is a function of the distance from the transmitter to the reflector and from the reflector to the receiver, and also it is a function of product of antennas pattern, transmit antenna patterns and receive antenna patterns. But we can have one simplification here, that is different things here, because each path has its own delay and it has its own factor loss. Yeah, we can simplify this further by assuming that the frequency band of a transmission, which is much lower than, smaller than the carrier frequency, we can say that in this situation, the delay and the loss is independent of frequency. So we can omit this term such that y of t will be just a function of time. These two factors, these two parameters, are not, and they can ignore frequency. So that only depends on time of transition. As an example for the case we had before, for the perfectly reflecting wall, that we have only two paths, one direct path and one reflected path, we have alpha 1 as the one constant, the amplitude of the factor loss over the distance. If we assume that the antenna moves at the velocity of v, and the second iteration is alpha over the, that is for a direct reflected path, which will be absolute value of alpha over 2d minus r0 plus vt. Sorry, minus vt, because the reflected path moves in opposite direction. So it is minus. And also the delay for these two paths will be so exactly like before. This is the delay that we had, and also we have the phase, instant phase of the first signal over 2 pi f, and for the second one will be r 2d minus over C, again in the phase over 2 pi f. So in this specific example, the first one can assume that is 0, the first phase, and the second one, top before pi, is reflected path has a difference of pi in phase. Okay, this is for the first direct path, and this is for the second path or reflected path. For linear channel, if we assume that the channel behaves as a linear system, then we can apply the convolution equations that relates the output to the input. We know that the output of the system, the linear system, can be expressed in terms of input by these equations. If we assume that channel has impulse response of h, which is kind of tau t, since this is time varying system, and multiply time input equations which can be expressed by relationship between input and output, that is summation of inputs multiplied by the activation. So by using this and combining these two, we can arrive at this equation, that is the impulse response of the time varying channel. So for the stationary channel, we can take out this term, the time. So it will be simplified to h of tau will be just alpha by delta tau minus tau tie tie minus tie up. We can define also another equation, another term, that is frequency response of channel. So frequency response, that is the term that used in frequency domain corresponding to the channel force response in time, which would be this, that is the frequency response of channel for that is in terms of time and frequency, defining as durations of is like Fourier transform of time and frequency. Tau here since this t and tau, tau and t, as we have here t and tau. E minus j 2 pi f tau d tau. And this, if we combine these two here, it will be summation of I alpha I t minus j 2 pi. Yeah, we have some phenomenon here. Sometimes, many cases in practice, the channel changes and not very fast. For example, for that reflecting wall, the time requires to change the characteristics of the channel is much less than the time speed or delay speed of the, each path. So in this case, we name this channel as a term underspeed channel. So underspeed channel, we can call this as underspeed channel. So it's happened when the time of requires for changing the channel, which is in order of milliseconds usually, is larger than the time of delay, which path or delay speed, which is in order of microseconds. So in this case, it's such a channel these characteristics called underspeed channel. When we transmit signal over the air, we know that the signal is up converted the frequency range of the original signal should be shifted to some range that's called the waiting frequency range. To this, we have an operation here, some mathematical calculations to transmit to translate the signals from the baseband to the equivalent passband and vice versa. So here we present a model for baseband equivalent model as we have the signal on the air as I discussed before as x of t or s of t, all the signals in the range of radio frequency, so that we should have that signal change to the baseband equivalent model. So here we present the baseband equivalent model. For example, if we have a spectrum of signal like this, S of F should be around the carrier frequency, radio frequency. If this spectrum has such a shape around the origin, it should be symmetric around this axis. And the bandwidth of the signal it's Bw, so that we have this for the spectrum of the signal on the air, now in the ground, in the receiver and transmitter, we have a signal like this, that is baseband equivalent model. So to be shaped like this, it be shifted back to this. So in the transmitter, we upconvert the signals from 0 to FC. In the receiver, we downconvert the signal from FC to 0, to the origin. So here, of course, FC should be greater than W. It is W over 2, because here W over 2. So FC should be somewhere here. And the frequency range of the signal is this, from FC plus half of W and FC minus half of W. So let's have some calculations here to convert the signals from, to reconstruct the signal from the baseband equivalent. So assume that we have SBT as a transform of S B F. So the frequency representation of this in baseband range will be like if you want to express this in terms of this, it will be square root of 2, because the two signals gather each other and you want to normalize the energy such that the energy of baseband and the passband are equal, and it will be SF plus FC when F plus FC greater than 0 and otherwise will be and if you want to have this in terms of this, this will be terms of SDF, we have two terms here. We have two terms, real form of x of pt, and imaginary form so this signal goes here and multiply the carrier frequency that is 2 pi FCT, here is the signal for this. This is oscillator. And it's minus pi over 2 shift. It multiplies with the imaginary part. So this will multiply this, and then this plus minus goes to the content. Okay, here antenna transmit, and in the receiver we have the signals first task 2, one path of course they added each other. Of course we have noise here, some noise here, so simplicity we ignore that one because we have this block, you know, to show what's the relationship between the real part and the baseband and the passband, that is S of T. And here we have the two path thing, and the first we have one, right? We're not knowing with the oscillator. minus w over 2 plus w2, and likewise here. And this gives us the original real part of xp and imaginary part of c. So this should be okay. Okay, there's something minus here, and this should be plus, and I should think it should be okay. I derived the equations to reconstruct the S of t from the equivalent basement equivalent model for S of t. So now I want to derive the equations for the output, if you consider that input has a baseband model and it's reconstructed from passband. And now if we have signal in the receiver, that is y of t, okay, then how we can reconstruct y bt from y t, the equivalent baseband equivalent of y bt from y t. So to do this, again we rewrite the previous equation that was x of t the square root of 2, real part of xat j 2 pi xat minus j 2 pi ct, and also in similar way we can have for y also the same equation. Then the real part of this you can write this way. Remember the equation y in terms of x, it was a summation of xi, alpha I t with four different paths. If we use that equation, plug in that equation here, we can rewrite the real part of y is dt. As summation of summation of each of these equations, right? I y t real part of x of x t t minus tau. And in similar way for imaginary this here the list of regimes. So we have maybe these two. When looking at this relationship between output and input, we can find the baseband equivalent channel as YBT equals to summation of some terms like on from YT baseband. Okay, we define it. What's that? XB T minus tau of T. So this is the relationship between output and input for baseband equivalent of X and Y. So if we express this relationship as this, then alpha, that is the baseband equivalent attenuation of T is alpha IT multiplied by minus J 2 pi FC also. So this is the channel attenuation in baseband. And also we can find the impulse response in baseband. So the equivalent impulse response will be HB tau T, because it is a function of two variables, time and delay, that is again summation of R over I this is the baseline equivalent of impulse response. So for a system, if you want to draw the block diagram of the transmitter and receiver, this is the same as before, except that on the air, instead of the constant, we should consider this one. We should put this block h of tau t on the air. So everything, the transmitter and the receiver, are all the same. So now we here finish this section, and the next section will be about the discrete time signals that is obtained by sampling this continuous signal at baseband model.